On the weekend of November 6th, 1960, John F. Kennedy made a final campaign trip to Connecticut. In just 2 days, he would be elected President of the United States. He would visit Bridgeport, Hartford, and New Haven. But history would be made in Waterbury, where Kennedy was greeted by more than 30,000 citizens at 3 a.m. in the morning. The Connecticut and Waterbury welcome would become a part of the nation's political legacy. There was no television news film available of Kennedy's Waterbury visit, but our research produced this home movie taken outside the Immaculate Conception Church by Esther Levenall's father, Michael. Kennedy is seen entering the Elton Hotel, where his daughter touched him. Later, he leaves the hotel and bids farewell to Waterbury.
It's gotten to be, everybody talks about Waterbury and that crowd. The press, of course, the press had a convoy of their own, buses and everybody going there. And these are all hardened newspaper men, political reporters, and they had never seen anything like that in any campaign. And you knew when you saw those crowds and the spirit and the verb, you knew he was going to get elected. My feeling is, too, the fact that this was the first Catholic nominated for president. And it was a first. And, of course, there was great pride. There was great pride. That area did have a large Catholic population. But my feeling is that Kennedy's strength, which I have always stated, Kennedy's strength is that he would appeal. He would appeal to people of every religion and every faith. And he did.
If you were here that night, you knew that night that that was something that was not going to be duplicated at any time in my lifetime. Number one, it took the individual. People came out for Kennedy, period.
FDR had been in Waterbury campaigning. I don't remember it. But presidential candidates did not normally get into Waterbury. It was something new. And in those days, Kennedy was young and attractive and had a different kind of appeal than most of the presidential candidates for the decade or more before him. And the fact that he was Catholic, he was young, he had a very attractive wife, all of that built and all of that added to the mystique. And he was Irish in a great Irish city, in a great Irish political city.
After Waterbury, Kennedy went to New Haven and Bridgeport and on to Long Island and to New Jersey City in New Jersey. He returned to Hartford on the Monday before Election Day, 1960, where he was again rejoined by Governor Ribicoff and other state officials. The crowds were gigantic and friendly. Later that day, before finishing in other parts of New England and heading back to Hyannis, he spoke to a large crowd in Springfield, Massachusetts.
I disagree with Mr. Nixon on the trend on what this country must do to maintain the peace and maintain our position in the world. And I am very sure that if we continue to drift and lie at anchor, we only see the beginning of our difficulties. But if this country goes back to work again, if it moves with purpose, if it moves with perseverance, there is nothing it cannot do, nothing.
But in the end, it was the Waterbury visit that would become the stuff of political folklore and a victory in Connecticut that was spread across the nation.
It was the first one in. The polls closed at 7 o'clock, and I was with President Kennedy when John Bailey called. The president, Bobby and myself, we had set up a command post in the Kennedy compound, but in Bobby's house.
It is known historically, Connecticut was always the first state to have the results, because every voting precinct, every voting precinct had a machine, a voting machine. So you would know very fast what the vote was, and key precincts you would extrapolate what was going on. There weren't any computers in those days. You had to figure it out in the arithmetic. And it became very obvious that he was taking Connecticut by a landslide. And that was a symbol, because the people were voting all over the country too. And as soon as we knew what the Connecticut score was, both John Bailey and I got a hold of Kennedy in Boston at the headquarters, and we told him what he had won by Connecticut was going for him in a big way. And of course, it was a close election, and Connecticut was the leader.
Mm-hmm. I was attending the Oak Hill School for the Blind at that time. I was in my second year high school. I remember going to school with my hat, my pin on all that day, and I wouldn't take it off. I wore it all day in class. I couldn't concentrate on anything I was doing that day. So probably my marks were a little bit lower that day, but that was all right. But I did follow, and even that night, we had a TV in our lounge where we stayed in the dormitories, and all of us were just glued to it because we just wanted to find out how Kennedy was going to make out. And of course, at that time, there was a sort of a big deal about his being Catholic and about his being 42 years old, and he was the youngest president, and being Roman Catholic and Irish. That was sort of a factor which shouldn't have played any role at all.
In fact, the proportion of the Democratic vote in Waterbury compared to the total electorate was bigger than Hartford, New Haven, or Bridgeport. Hartford had more Democratic votes total, but the proportion between Democrat and Republican was nowhere near as great as in Waterbury.
Writing in a column that recalled President Kennedy's historic visit to Waterbury, Sherman London noted that Kennedy pledged to return the Saturday night before the 1964 presidential election. It was supposed to be another 3 a.m. visit. An assassin's bullet prevented him from keeping that promise.
To meet Jack Kennedy was to like him, but to know him was to want to help him. This fellow, Jack Kennedy, was the most natural politician I ever met without seeming to be.
I would say I think his greatest contribution was the inspiration he gave to the young people of America. Politics today has become very, very cynical. People are unhappy. They're tired of the president. They're tired of Congress. They want change. People want to change. And Roosevelt had that inspirational quality, but Kennedy had that great inspirational quality that he had with the people of the country. And he gave them something. The young people got interested. The young people don't care about politics anymore. But he made politics a very respectable institution because they believed in him. They had pride in him. And I think that was his greatest contribution.